They will be discriminatory. We should not have them. As London Mayor, I will speak out against them, and I will obfuscate and delay their implementation in London. I hope so, because they said they were going to implement them in pubs, or it's Johnson regime. And they broke back on that for now.
It shall die.
The fear is that they might try to implement them in churches and other places of worship, which is why these different clergymen from all kinds of different Christian denominations have come together to write to the government and say, don't implement them in churches. They shouldn't implement them either in pubs or churches or anywhere else. It's my view. The view of the Heritage Party, I've been speaking about it from the beginning. You won't get that view from any of the mainstream parties. They're all for it. They're all going for it. Well, maybe with one or two. You know, there's a few exceptions here and there, but the majority of the big two parties are for it. They shouldn't be implemented, because it's going to pave the way for digital identity. Chinese Communist Party style social credit digital identity, which is taking things for good.
Can I ask, you've got a candidate standing in the Hartlepool by-election. Do you have anything to say about that?
We have a fantastic candidate, Claire Martin, who's standing in Hartlepool by-election. I'm really proud of her. She's new to politics, but she really believes in everything the Heritage Party stands for, including freedom, getting back our freedom after the lockdown and so on. She'll be fighting for that, and she'll also be fighting for local issues that concern Hartlepool, such as fighting to keep the hospital open there and stopping various bits of the hospital being closed down and so on, which I know is an issue in Hartlepool. And we used to last year talk about Brexit a lot, and for a town like Hartlepool, there's immense opportunities to be had after Brexit, which is reviving the fishing industry, reviving manufacturing industry in the Hartlepool, which is very much a post-industrial town, but it's got an awful lot of potential to revive there. So she's going to be fighting for her town, and she's actually the only party candidate who's actually from Hartlepool. I mean, all of the other parties, the Tory Party, Labour Party, Lib Dems, Greens, whatever, they're all bussing people in from outside, but she actually lives in Hartlepool and has all her life, and so I think she's the best qualified person to stand to be Hartlepool's MP. I'm really proud of her, and I think when people in Hartlepool get to know her and see her, they'll vote for her as well.
And so can I take this as sort of the first great expansion of the Heritage Party outside of London and around the country to make it a truly national party?
Absolutely. I'm really happy about that, because I know a lot of people know I'm standing for London Mayor. I'm standing for the London Assembly with other candidates like Sean Finch, who's a great candidate too. He's over there. But we've got 30 candidates in local elections all around the country as well, from Cumbria to East Sussex to Devon. Claire is standing in the Hartlepool local elections too, Nottinghamshire, Lincolnshire, all around the country we've got candidates in various places. So this is the beginning of the Heritage Party branching out nationally. It is wonderful, considering we only opened for membership about 5 months ago. So we've got hundreds of people have joined us, and many of the current candidates. I'm really proud of them all. And my aim and my vision is to grow big enough so that when the next general election comes, either in 2 or 3 years' time, we can stand candidates in every single constituency and give people a real choice to take back political power from the two-party system and give it back to the people.
So, talking about the next general election, or even talking about elections coming up after this mayoral election, obviously the Heritage Party is a small party, but it's rapidly growing.
Yes.
There are other parties who may have a lot of things in common with the Heritage Party, who, you're not necessarily super opposed to, you just prefer yourself.
Yeah.
Do you think there's a possibility that, especially with the council election coming up, that you might try and work with other parties to spread candidates around so every single ward has an alternative candidate to vote for?
I think that's a very sensible possible thing, and I think that's something I'm going to be looking into for the council elections in May 2022, because there'll be another 5,000 seats or something up for grabs in those. In London, you know, you've got the London borough elections in next year, so there'll be about 2,000 seats just in London. So, you know, I think we, you know, I've already spoken to a well-known group who may mediate between some of the parties. I'm not going to say who it is at the moment. I'm going to keep that completely quiet and secret. But there is someone willing to work with, you know, an independent organisation that may be willing to work with different parties so that we can, you know, together fill every seat and not stand against each other. So, so that, that would be a good thing for next year.
I did have a couple of questions. I want to give some people a chance. Any questions?
So you think
standing for that?
What's your view on the pandemic? I've just been reading here.
Yeah.
And you say there is unusual symptoms. Some repackaging.
Some what?
Repackaging symptoms.
Yeah, I mean, when you talk about COVID-19, the symptoms that they say are quite general, you know, a cough and a headache and so on. The serious symptoms are when people then suffer bilateral pneumonia, which is what you saw at the beginning in Italy, but mainly among older people, you know, people in their 80s mainly. So the people who have died from COVID mainly, the average age has been 82. So it's mainly affecting older people. But, you know, no, absolutely not. No, as I've said, I completely disagree with that, and I have done from the beginning. You need to look after people who are ill and sick, but you shouldn't have shut down the entire nation for something like this, which is no worse than the bad flu season. Yeah. Yeah.
And then just reopening the one space.
Yeah, well, we have all kinds of different words being used for this: new normal, build back better, new world order, you know, you've got Agenda 2030, they're all sort of like different sides of the same cube, if you like. And they're trying to do, the Great Reset is another one, the World Economic Forum talks about, but it's kind of probably most descriptive. Smashing small and medium-sized businesses, taking away our freedom, getting people to wear masks for no reason whatsoever, and totally changing society. This is what some people are actually actively trying to do. They haven't asked me, they haven't asked anybody here whether it's what we want, and if they did, no one would say that they wanted it. So this has been blown up into a crisis which is way disproportionate to what it is, and it should never have happened. We should have done what they did in, for example, Tanzania, which has kept everything open. Prescribed hydroxychloroquine, but you see what happened in Tanzania as the president, Magufuli, was bumped off and killed. You know, but I think what they did was the right course of action. That was a good way too, absolutely, yeah. Yeah. Absolutely, and you see in Sweden there was no difference in the total mortality rates in Sweden as in the UK, as you say. And they didn't lock down, we did, but there was no difference.
What's your opinion on the US? The ULEZ expansion.
I am totally against the ULEZ expansion to the North and South Circular Roads. It's going to hurt millions of people who drive vehicles, especially business owners who have just upgraded their vehicles, and now they'll have to upgrade them again or pay a £12 a day charge to drive into inner London. It's basically a shakedown to get another £300 million a year for TfL, because TfL's finances are shot. We shouldn't be doing it, and I'm against it, and I won't expand it.
I wanted to ask, you're a teacher, David.
Yeah.
And the Heritage Party, you're obviously standing for Mayor of London, but I'd like to ask, like, broader as your national policy, what are you going to do about the maleducation system that we have in this country, the state education?
Yeah, I mean, education needs to be focused once again on excellence and on teaching young people the skills they need stand on their own two feet when they're an adult. And a lot of what you've got is cultural Marxism in schools. I mean, particularly through these three extra subjects, which are pumping out all the government's sort of fringe policies, which is citizenship, relationships and sex education, and personal, social and health education, which are not examinable subjects, but, you know, they've put in all of the sort of controversial things which are, you know, cultural Marxist agendas in there. So kids learn about Black Lives Matter, decolonising Britain, why Britain is bad, learn about gender theory and queer theory when they're kids. Their boys and girls learn that they're not actually boys and girls, they're gender fluid and so on. And it's against a lot of parents' wishes, because I believe parents are the primary educators of their children, and they need to take an active role in educating their children. So I'm all for homeschooling, for people who want to homeschool, and I'll support that. But, you know, it's not possible for everybody, but schools, there are some good schools still. There are some good ones. But there are a lot of schools which are very bad and are just, you know, not teaching kids the things that they need to survive. So I think it needs a real going over. And, you know, in the secondary sector, I would want to implement again the tripartite system of grammar schools, technical schools and vocational schools. Schools, because, you know, different kids have different needs and different aptitudes. So that's one fundamental thing that we need to do.
Do you support a voucher system so that if people choose to homeschool their kids, they can have the same amount of funding that their child would have got in a state school to educate their child themselves, or have someone that they know, a friend or family member, educate their children?
I haven't released our very specific sort of general election manifesto yet, but something I am looking into, it's a really good idea, it just needs to be costed. So I can't promise to do that at the moment because I need to work out what that will actually cost. Because, you know, I do believe in austerity, if you like, spending within your means. So I'm not going to promise, you know, another £10 billion if that's what it costs and the money's not there. But it is something that, in principle, I think is a great idea. But I need to work out if we can afford it first.
And you're talking about saving money as the government. Where are the places that you think that the government could either raise revenues, or the most obvious places they can raise revenues, or they can cut their spending?
Well, I think there's an ample room for cutting spending. First of all, in HS2, they've wasted so much money on this kind of vaccines and vaccine passport system and that stuff which is coming this year. That can all go, track and trace. Lots of subsidies for so-called green energy and wind farms and so on that don't produce an awful lot of energy and electricity. And quangos as well. There's, I think, something like £90 billion goes into quangos, a lot of them which actually then lobby the government again. So we need a bonfire of the quangos and get rid of a lot of them that are just basically not doing anything of any value to society whatsoever. Yeah.
There's a couple of very controversial court cases going on in America at the moment. We've already seen riots in New York, Portland, Oregon, places like that where BLM are very much in the eye of the public. Are you concerned that this could happen in this country? Should those court cases have a controversial ending? Because we already saw the police capitulate to BLM in central London a few months ago.
We did.
How do you think that could pan out under this current calm?
What happened in America last summer after the death of George Floyd, it spread all over the world rapidly. It was something that happened in Minneapolis. It happened in the United States. But here is a different country. We don't have that problem in this country. But it sort of spread anyway, and it was whipped up by people using it for political gain. You know, the Sadiq Khan said, "I feel your pain." He didn't sort of say protest, but that was at a time when there were restrictions in place. But he was almost saying, you know, "I understand if you do want to protest." But it would have been completely different to the Freedom Rally. But at the moment, what's going on with the court case, it's going through the court now, it doesn't seem to be the same kind of contagion and spread to this country and around the world that we saw last summer. So I'm hoping, you know, whatever the result will be, is that the effects of that will just be contained to the United States. There's no reason for it to come over here.
There would be less of a chance of that happening if we didn't have a mayor of London who was sympathetic to those troublemaking countries.
Well, that's right. And you know, I don't agree with Black Lives Matter. I don't agree with BLM. I don't agree with their aims. They're against the family. They're against the free market and capitalism. They want to defund the police. They're basically, you know, a bunch of far left anarchists, as far as I can see. I don't agree with them whatsoever. I do, you know, have the right to protest peacefully, but I don't agree with them. But you know, if I'm the mayor, then I will police fairly and equally. So I will, you know, allow them to demonstrate, but I will not allow them to get violent, and I certainly won't have police officers getting down on their knees in front of far left marchers.
What if they want to do up their shoelaces?
They can do up their own shoelaces.
But what if they want to kneel down to do them up? Is that okay?
Oh, the police officers?
Yeah.
I think they can go somewhere private and do that.
Sorry.
Nobody should be killed by police or anyone. But the man had apparently a dose of fentanyl in his blood, which would have killed him 3 times over. So according to many medics, he would have died anyway. I mean, I'm sorry for any drug addict to die, but it's terrible. Obviously, you feel good at it. But blaming the police for this is a bit unfair.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, what was wrong with it was they stirred up the narrative of racism and systemic racism. I don't think this was, I don't think this was a racist incident at all. I mean, maybe there was brutality, but maybe not. I don't know. This is going through the courts at the moment. But I've seen police brutality in London, so that exists. But But I don't accept that this is like there's systemic racism everywhere that, you know, needs some kind of fundamental change to society. There we go. Lovely to answer your questions. Great to see you all. Thank you very much, everyone. Lovely to be here. Please vote. Heritage.